pero aquel esplendoroso porvenir comenzó a desmoronarse. En los Juegos Olímpicos de Seúl empezó su martirio con las lesiones.
Derek, you've pulled out the 400. Why?
I've had an Achilles tendon problem for about the last 4 or 5 weeks, and we've given it as much treatment as we can in the last 3 weeks. Just before I came out here, I wasn't able to train properly, and I started to warm up and it was fine, but halfway through my warm up, the pain just came back, and I couldn't run on it, mentally or physically.
So when I got injured in Seoul, I was very upset, very angry, and it just made me a lot more determined to win a medal in Barcelona.
Dice el tópico que una lesión es el peor enemigo para un deportista. Derek pasó 13 veces por el quirófano, la última 4 meses antes de Barcelona.
No, it wasn't an obsession, it was my life. So that's possibly more than obsession.
Fue en la capital japonesa donde experimentó la mayor alegría que le ha proporcionado el atletismo. Junto a Roger Black, John Regis y Chris Akabusi, se convirtió en campeón del mundo en el relevo largo al vencer al todopoderoso equipo estadounidense por tan solo 4 centésimas. Muy diferente es el Derek que correteaba por las calles de su pueblo, al de ahora. Ahora es un tipo con éxito, pero entre medias han ocurrido muchas cosas. Cosas por las que ha reído, por las que ha llorado, por las que ha odiado, y todas por culpa del atletismo. La desgracia que padeció en el 92 ha tenido su recompensa.
I've traveled many a mile and haven't found a home. I've traveled many a mile and one seed's unsown. I'll travel another mile.
Derek da conferencias de motivación y el contenido de esas charlas está cargado de su experiencia como atleta, de sus éxitos y de sus fracasos. Esta de Ipswich la dio ante trabajadores de una multinacional de seguros.
We concentrated on our product, and our product in that race was the relay baton. You've got 4 guys that come from 4 different backgrounds and have to come together for one race, and we have to act like we're a team, have been training forever. So the only thing we could do was concentrate on our product, which was the relay baton. And the rules state that it's the first team to get the relay baton around the track the quickest over 4 laps will be deemed the winner. So that was important. And the same with you, you need to concentrate on whatever your product is. So that's another similarity between the sportsman and the businessman.
Fue Fran Dick, jefe de los entrenadores del equipo británico en el 92, quien animó a Derek a que se dedicase a contar su experiencia.
His real strength at this point was a conversation kind of style. He makes everyone in the audience feel that he's speaking to them personally. And this is a big gift. He also has this unique experience of seeing what he believed to be his dream broken in front of him, but he saw the possibility that you can fight through anything and get to your goal. And this is a big message that Derek can give to everyone, because he's lived it. He's lived this experience himself.
If that hadn't have happened, I wouldn't be doing what I do for work now. I wouldn't be possibly a motivational speaker. And if I was a speaker, I possibly wouldn't have such a powerful story to be able to tell.
Y llega el momento de recordar ante el público lo doloroso que es caer por culpa de una lesión en unos juegos, sobre todo cuando se es favorito para la medalla de oro.
That Barcelona race in 1992 turned out to be the worst day of my life. Sometimes in life, things don't always go to plan, and we end up finding ourselves hitting a brick wall. We have a problem. The secret is not to think of it as a problem. It is a challenge.
Hay héroes olímpicos que lo son con todos los pronunciamientos. Muy pocos pueden hablar de triunfo y otros no tienen otra satisfacción que la de competir. Gente que se marcha con un regusto amargo por culpa del fracaso. Pero hay derrotas y derrotas. Alguna tan hermosa como la victoria más brillante.
The night before, we looked at the lineup for the semi-final, and I actually thought, well, so long as Derek gets round, he's in the final.
We knew that there was something there, and we should see something in the final. There was no sign of any injury taking place, but the goal was always available.
start of the 400. This is where I started.
Redmond to aim at.
I was certainly top three.
Yeah.
Going into the back straight, where I needed to be. It was okay. There was no problems.
Con cada zancada se aleja más de un pasado doloroso, oscuro. Pero el pasado es más rápido que él.
So I remember all this now. I remember all this color stands.
Le apresa y le desgarra.
Somewhere here that I heard the funny pop, and I remember thinking I thought it was in the crowd. I remember thinking, concentrate, concentrate.
And Derek Redmond, on his injury problem, the jinx has struck again.
The moment he went down, there was no chance of him coming back, and we know that was the end of the game and the Olympics for Derek.
And I thought, God, why? Why have you picked on Derek? You know, what has he done to deserve this?
And then I think I sat on the floor.
Yeah,
sat on the track on a bit
for a few seconds.
By the time I was on the floor long enough for them to get somewhere around here. Because it was when I saw them coming into the home straight, that's when I decided to get up and to start running.
Momentos como este concentran el espíritu de toda una vida.
Four rounds. And I'm not happy to see him hopping like this because his Achilles tendon is very, very brittle.
I understood why he got up. He wanted to be beaten by the opposition rather than be beaten by his own body.
And I just couldn't believe, it happened again. So a lot of shock, frustration and anger really were the things that I felt.
I was literally saying to myself, don't do this, Derek. Don't put yourself through this pain. Stop.
When I saw them, all the other athletes had about 100 metres, maybe 110 metres to go. And I just thought if I got up and started running, I could still catch them. About here, and I remember looking across to see if I was catching them, and then they had finished. And the only thing on my mind now was just to finish the race. That's all I was thinking, finish, finish, finish. Because it might be the last race I ever run.
Well, Dad was stood next to me, and Dad just turned to me and said, hold this, and he gave me his camera. And then I saw Dad running down the steps, and I was thinking, well, what are you doing?
3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. About midway, yeah? This was open. And then I ran and jumped from here to there. I ran down to the track, not to do anything other than to give him an aid of assistance because he was in pain.
He's obviously decided he just wants to finish. His dad's trying to run under the track to stop him. He's going to tell him, Derek, don't. There's going to be an argument between father and son.
It was a split-second decision. It wasn't planned. So I suppose it's fatherly instinct.
I couldn't believe he was on the track, and he just said to me, you can stop, you don't need to do this. And I just said, get me back into lane five, get me back into lane five, I want to finish the race.
And we both went together.
Jim was intuitive. He went to his son's side to make sure that he would finish what he'd come to finish.
By the time I got to here, you'd caught up with me.
Yeah.
And slowed me down.
I thought we'd gone to the stage where he will inflict more damage, possibly serious damage to his legs.
I think athletics was like a big canvas that he was going to paint his story on. The story in the end was not the one he planned.
He did take my advice at the end, after the race, and let's stop racing. There was too much injury.
I hated athletics, and I was sort of, in my head, I was going, why me, why me? But I could never, ever get that time back. I could never go back and re-replicate that race, win it, get into the final, and win a medal. Pain is temporary, but the glory lasts forever.
Oh, I know you win this time.